Hello everyone, and welcome to the very second episode of Research Done. It's been a month since the last episode, and I'm really sorry for that. But building such an enclosure for no one else but Mr. Zoof himself takes some time. That time also allowed me to think about the whole series, think a lot actually, and so I made this slightly updated plan for every episode, which has more precise categories than ever before. In this episode there won't be a tour, as it is on Zoof's channel. And if you haven't seen it, check it out. Link should appear somewhere now. I think it will be in the right top corner. Also, there will be a special guest in this video, which is an animal. But to know who it is, you need to wait. But not to make it any more longer, prepare your pens and notebooks. We will start with the size. African wild dogs, or as I will call them, painted dogs, require large, complex enclosure which size depends on the type of the facility. AZA mentions 4 standards that should be put under consideration while planning the enclosure. If you want to have a group consisting of animals of the same gender, which will spend their whole life in zoological gardens, you must have an outdoor enclosure of at least 465 square meters and 2 holding areas 19 square meters each. It's measured for 2 animals, and every extra animal requires additional 93 square meters of primary enclosure space. If you want to have a single generation breeding facility, you need to start with primary enclosure measuring 930 square meters and 3 holding areas 19 square meters each. There is no expansion pattern for reproductive groups, so only keep overcrowding in mind. If you are taking the challenge more seriously and want to have a multi-generational breeding facility, you should start with primary enclosure measuring 930 square meters or larger, with additional outdoor enclosure measuring 465 square meters and 3 holding areas 19 square meters each, as it is the standard. And if you want to build a conservation project or a zoo that wants to release their painted dogs back to the wild, you need a bigger enclosure measuring at least 1860 square meters, secondary enclosure of 465 square meters and 3 holding areas 19 square meters each. Ouch, that was a lot of rules. Don't worry about it though. One more thing to note in this point is that you should make your enclosure on a base of square or rectangle. Use this space to make nice, open enclosures rather than making long, thin, corridor-like enclosures. Topography. Topography of a painted dog enclosure is a key to their happy lives. While landscaping the whole area, remember about open spaces, hills for observation, dense, natural walls and holes. It will allow animals to hide from or observe the guests, but also form places for every pack member. For example, every painted dog sleeps or rests few meters away from the others. That's a little fun fact. Fencing. Fencing landed in this category as it is vital to take few rules under consideration while building the whole enclosure. If the enclosure is surrounded with mesh barrier, it should be at least 2.5 meter tall, with a 1 meter overhanging barrier extending into the enclosure at a 35 to 45 upward angle. Also, mesh should have the smallest eyes possible, so painted dogs can't stick their snouts through it. These eyes should be even smaller if the enclosure shares fence with other habitat. We don't want our dogs to have their tails bitten off, do we? If you decide to have solid barriers, you should keep them at least 2.5 meter high, but 3.5 meter tall ones are preferable. Also keep trees away from the fence as they might allow escapes. Moats. Moats are also mentioned by Association of Zoos and Aquariums as a type of containment for African wild dogs. The moat should be at least 5.5 meter wide and have a vertical wall which suits the 3.5 meter requirement. Size of the moat facing the enclosure should be tilted at 30 degrees from horizontal, and dry moats should be monitored after snowfalls. Wet moats should have the same dimensions as their dry counterparts, but have an additional anti-climbing on its end. When you have puppies, things are getting more complicated as you must dry out the moat and slope down all the walls facing the enclosure that weren't sloped down earlier. Security. Security is the main point while dealing with carnivores. While building painted dog enclosure, you should always use double doors where possible, avoid gaps within the fencing, put a lot of effort to make your gates automatized and electrified, and keep guests away from the mesh barriers by placing down the guest fence. Also, every part of the enclosure must be accessible by keeper, including chutes. Secondary perimeter fence is also advised as it stops escapees. Substrate. Painted dogs should be kept on natural substrates such as grass, sand, forest litter, or dirt. Always avoid concrete for areas where canines spend longer periods of time. Using natural substrates rather than hard material increases the believability of the enclosure and allows animals to perform natural behaviors as sunbathing and digging. Foliage. Painted dogs will live with any foliage you offer them, although it needs to be lush. Trees and bushes make up for great hiding spots and places to rest, although keep them away from the barriers. Tall grasses are also highly recommended as they allow dogs to play, hide and seek. If you have mind for imagining things, imagine them playing hide and seek in a long grass. It is sweet, right? Also, don't spare money on foliage. Painted dogs don't destroy plants, they only create paths for them, which can be achieved in Planet Zoo by leaving some space between patches of grass and painting sand over there. Recommended items for this point are Dreen grass, Eel grass, Nitraria bush, Diamond leaf willow, Triodia grass. Hiding. African wild dogs are canines, and that means they need some privacy, as all of us. According to Association of Zoos and Aquariums, 50% of the perimeter fence can be viewable at highest, and the rest of the enclosure should function as a hiding place. It's done due to the fact that dogs and wolves perform abnormal activities while being stressed, as hair loss for example. And we don't our dogs bold! To achieve top level hiding features, you should furnish the enclosure with deadlocks, man-made dens, ground barriers, bushes, trees, PVC tubes or terrain manipulation, like in my case. To do that, you need to raise the terrain slightly above guest's eye range and lower it in the back. This way, painted dogs will walk unnoticed and have their private mansion. Recommended items for this point are Planet Zoo log, North African painted beams, African branches, jetty bedding beams, faux tree trunk, faux branches and roots. Digging. African wild dogs like to dig and it's completely normal. They'll try to dig their dens in every natural material possible, which is a behavior slightly forbidden and commonly fought by keepers. The pleasure these animals get from digging means that they might try and escape below fences. That's why many zoos all around the world install 90 cm wide mesh sections at 90-degree angle to the vertical fence 50 to 30 cm below the ground level. In Planet Zoo, it would be a complete waste of pieces, said me. So to show that you remember about digging, do a concrete base under your fence, which in real life should be 15 to 20 cm wide, and bury it 90 to 120 cm into the ground. And always remember to pour the concrete below access gates. You don't want them to become exit for animals too. Heat and shade. African wild dogs originate from Africa, where temperatures are pretty high, and so that means that they might suffer from colder weather. The minimal temperature that they can take for an extended period of time is about 4.4 to 7.2 degrees Celsius. In other cases, however, when it's hotter you can install it too, you should provide your painted dogs with a man-made burrow featuring heat lamps or constant access to an area with temperature-controlled environment as backstage. As shade goes, cloth sunshades, canopies, overhanging rock formation or trees should be places without sun impact. Water features. Painted dogs don't mind swimming. They're rather good, if not excellent, swimmers. However, water features are a necessity for every enclosure. Pools and shallow paths of water are advised for habitats where the temperature is rather high, and so your dogs can use it to cool off slightly. They don't need to be present in the main enclosure, but you need to ensure that they have constant access to it. Viewing areas. Guests want to have the best sight at animals possible. That's why you can use a variety of ideas to fulfill that need. Install glass panel in your fences, make raised viewing galleries, put paths near the moats and so on. The only rule is to keep guests away from the fences that can lead to direct contact with animals, mesh barriers and metal bars. Holding pens. Holding pens are vital parts of painted dog's enclosure. They serve as a place to hide, sleep, eat, drink or even play. Association of Zoos and Aquariums advises that those areas are at least 19 square meters, but no bigger than 46.5 square meters. These areas should be easy to clean, any pipes should be visible due to dog's destructive nature, and easily accessible via mechanically controlled gate. Two types of gates are advised, guillotine gates and sliding gates. Both of them should have electric locks, as a fully grown painted dog can lift or move them. Not with ease, of course, he isn't a culturist. Food and water. Food and water should be served hot and fresh inside the holding pens, in a way that lets keepers avoid direct contact with animals. This can be executed via food chutes or feeding trays as shown in my build. Water dispenser can be automatized and pour water into the bowl after a gentle button click. Indoor playing areas. A perfect African white dog enclosure consists of primary enclosure, holding areas and indoor playing area, which is used when temperatures might get too hot or low during exact periods of time. In such cases, this room should have a natural substrate, branches, logs, scratch posts, planters to increase the appearance and shouldn't be open all day and all night. It also needs to be accessible at any time and have a high security gate. Temperature and lighting. Indoor areas for African white dogs should have a controlled environment with fresh air from air conditioning and temperature kept warm at all times. Lighting should be as natural as possible. Sunroofs are highly recommended in indoor play areas. If there's no chance for installing sunroofs, blue or white light should be provided in forms of lamp programmed to such a degree that they will represent day-night cycle. Enrichment. Dogs are playful, we all know that. Painted dogs are no different and they need a lot of things to play with. While furnishing their enclosure, always remember about scratching posts, prey sacks, piñatas, balls, chewing toys and puzzles. Lining. To give your backstage areas a little bit more detail, use lines on the ground to show safe distance from mesh barriers behind which painted dogs roam. Space sharing. African white dogs can't share enclosure with any other species due to their aggressive nature. Research done specials. Should we take our dogs as examples while building painted dog enclosure? Meet Fada. She is my 12-year-old dog, who is the cutest, loveliest and smartest dog I have ever seen. Today she has a special role, to help me answer the question presented to you few seconds ago. First thing we are going to look at is the jumping. I've done few calculations before anything, comparing how tall she is to the fully grown painted dog and then adjusting the minimal fence requirements. I know she is old and that might determine her jump, but I can assure you that when she was younger she didn't want to jump either. First challenge I set for her is this little table and as you can see, she reached it. I wanted to record it through a different angle, but it ended pretty bad, so moving on. The second barrier was this thingy that helps clothes dry out. And it was a barrier that couldn't be crossed, 71 centimeters of depth. As I saw it was the end of the research, I let her out, gave her a little pat-pat and went to measure the height of our perimeter fence. In its lowest point it was 1.37 meters, so more than enough to stop her, but way low under minimal fence requirements. Next stop on our list were water features, and I went a little bit more cruel, using a water gun I found in my garage. Well hidden, I gave a shot and she didn't like it. She doesn't like water in general, baths are the worst. Raspberry break. To sum it up, don't you ever think that your dog can be a source of information for your painted dog enclosure. Although they're from the same family, domesticated dogs don't have abilities of wild ones. Of course, there are a few similarities. Fada, for example, loves digging, sleeping in the sun and entering her backstage area through access gates. But I do recommend to watch research done instead of your dog forcing a small fence. And that would be all for today's episode of Research Done. Next episode will premiere in 3 weeks at least. I know it's long, but it will be a material for 2 episodes in a row. Penguins won't come soon, my apologies to everyone who voted in the survey, and with the release of North America Animal Pack, my plans for them might be postponed even further. In upcoming 2 weeks, watch out for a few surprises I have prepared for you, make sure to follow me on Twitter, I'm very active there, and go thank Mr. Zuf for letting me build this painted dog enclosure in Limpopo. But not to make any more longer, I'll see you in the next episode of Research Done. Goodbye!